It was a different kind of Passover, to say the least. You know, we had just sat down and Philip leaned over and whispered to me, he said, "Hey, Thomas, I think something really special is going to happen tonight." I said, "Well, I doubt it." But I was wrong. Jesus, he got up and he went and got a basin of water and some towels, and I sat there thinking to myself, what's Jesus doing with the foot water? Surely he's not going to wash somebody's feet. I was wrong again. You know, he knelt down and started to wash Bartholomew's feet. And old Bart, he just sat there frozen. He didn't move, didn't say a thing. None of us did. Jesus finished and he went up to James and Andrew, and you know, I was sitting there thinking to myself, this is so strange, but yet so wonderful. I thought to myself, no one is going to say anything right now. But I was wrong. You know who broke the silence? Peter.
"No way can you wash my feet." I told him, he's not going to be washing my feet. He can wash their feet, but he cannot wash my feet. So I looked at him and I said, "Jesus, you can wash their feet. You just can't wash mine. I mean, you're the king." And Jesus looked at me and he said, "Peter, then you'll have no part in me." I was like, ouch. Okay, wash my feet, wash my hands, wash my body if you have to. Jesus, just wash me. And he looked at me and he said, "Peter, just your feet will do." You know, when Jesus washed our feet, he was teaching us about servanthood.
Then Jesus took some bread and some wine and he blessed it and served it to us. He said, "This is a new covenant of his blood." And he said that tonight, all of you will lose faith in me. And I sat there thinking to myself, lose faith in you? Never. Never would I do that. But I just sat there. I didn't say anything.
I couldn't just sit there. I had to say something. So I looked at him and I said, "Jesus, I love you. Everybody else might fall away, but I will always be there." And Jesus just looked at me and he said, "Peter, you'll deny me 3 times before morning." Ouch. Next thing I know, we're wrapping things up and heading to the garden to pray.
Once we got in the garden, things just got crazy. Jesus asked Peter, James, and myself to go further in the garden with him and pray. Well, we did. Well, we tried. We just kept falling asleep. And Jesus kept waking us up. Now, I remember one time that Jesus told us, he said, "The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." That's the truth. I mean, it's just all a blur. Just to think that all this got started because of Judas. I mean, did he really think that what he was doing was right?
There he is. He's the one you want, the one praying by himself. Now the others, they may come up and try to create some scene, but the one I kiss on the cheek, that's the one you want. Now, 30 pieces of silver for this, right? That's what we agreed upon, 30 pieces. Forget about the rest, the one I kiss on the cheek, that's the one you want.
A kiss? I mean, Judas betrayed Jesus with a kiss of a friend? Then things really got crazy. Peter, he reached down and he grabs his sword and he cut this guy's ear off and fell to the ground. And Jesus just picked it up and put it right back on the guy's head. Like nothing ever happened. And then they took him. I'd love to tell you that we fought for him, but we didn't. We just ran. I ran. I'm so ashamed.
What have I done? What have I done? Was I so stupid to think I've killed him? I've killed him. I've crucified Jesus.
I crucified Jesus. It's what the crowd wanted. That's what the crowd got. Personally, I don't think that man deserved that. But I was just a soldier doing my job. When the governor gave his orders, that's when I'd go to work. I loved that job. Felt like I was administrating justice every time I nailed someone to the tree. That man didn't deserve that. Just didn't make sense to me.
It makes no sense. There I was, sitting in a jail cell, rotting away for stealing, murdering, you name it, I had done it. I knew the next time I stepped out of that cell, that was it. And then when the guards came and got me, they stood me beside this man. He'd been beaten to a pulp. Then Governor Pilate, he says, "Which of these men shall we set free?" It was obvious. I knew they were going to say, "Let Jesus go." Then I was going to tell them where to go. And then all of a sudden the crowd starts chanting, "Barabbas." They were chanting my name over and over. The crowd was chanting my name. And then all of a sudden the guards just pushed me into the crowd. Then they took Jesus to Golgotha. 1 minute, I'm standing there as a man marked for death. The next minute, I'm a free man. It makes no sense. So I followed him all the way to Golgotha.
I was stationed at Golgotha that day. We just raised a second criminal when they brought him to me. He was unrecognizable as a man when they brought him to me. He was beaten, whipped, spit on, hideous. What was left of his clothes was thrown off of him when he was laid down at the cross. And that's when I went to work. Generally, when we crucify a man, we'd have two soldiers hold him down. But this guy, he didn't do that. He didn't put up a fight. I thought he's just exhausted. As an executioner, I've been called every name in the book. I've been yelled at, pleaded with, but I wasn't ready for that. He looked at us. He looked at me. And he said, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they've done." He forgave me.
Forgive them. He said, "Forgive them." Who is he? Forgive? It should have been me hanging up there. I should have been the one hanging on that cross. But he took my place. I remember I looked up and I saw him take one deep, agonizing breath. And then he said, "It is finished." And then he died.
Surely, this man is the Son of